evening and welcome to tonight's sleep lecture. Tonight's lecture is part of our Dr. Marvin Small Memorial Parent Workshop Series. Every other month we have a different topic. This is obviously a very popular topic with sleep, but I'd also like to highlight a couple of the resources available to you. Our community resource center just across the lobby has a great parenting and pregnancy section. And we'd love to open that up and support any topics that you might be interested in. I did pull some of the relevant books for tonight's topic. These are examples of books that are available to be checked out in our resource center. We have classes, so a series of prenatal classes, DVDs as well. So we'd like to invite you to all take advantage of our community resource center and upcoming parent workshops. In March, we're going to be hosting a Bye-Bye Diapers lecture. So many of you that are working on the sleep issue now might be ready in May to address the diapers. We'd love to have you back. Please do check our pamf.org webpage periodically to find out about upcoming lectures, or let us know a topic that you might be interested in. There are program evaluations for tonight's workshop. I'd love to have you fill one of those out at the end of tonight's lecture. And please mention any topics that you might be interested in. We'll try to bring those in future workshops. Tonight's lecture is going to be recorded. So the three lectures on the flyer available just outside the door are going to be available for checkout. Sometime in the end of March, we'll be able to lend this as well as the positive discipline and bye-bye diapers lectures that are on this flyer. Will be available to be checked out on disk. So we'll hope to be able to provide this. If you miss anything in your notes, come and borrow it in May, and we'll make sure that you have all the information. Tonight's presenter is one of our very own pediatricians. She has also got some great experience with sleep, being the mother of three children herself, has employed some of the techniques that she's going to discuss tonight. So I would like to turn tonight's presentation over to Dr. Elizabeth Copeland, one of our wonderful PAMF pediatricians.
Thank you. Hello. Nice to see you. I see a few familiar faces around of some of my own patients, a few. Wanted to thank you guys all for coming. So tonight I'm going to talk about some sleep basics. A couple people came up already and sort of said, is this all about babies? I'm totally happy to talk about sleep in any age group. And one of the first things I wanted to do was get kind of a sense of what the age of the child that you're here for is. And that way I can gear the presentation a little bit. A lot of the stuff that we're going to talk about at the beginning is actually sort of basic sleep theory and lay some of the groundwork about why you might be having sleep issues. I sort of assume you're having sleep issues or you wouldn't be here. You can correct me if I'm wrong. Basically we're going to go through some basic sleep stuff. We're going to talk about babies a little bit because usually this is a pretty popular lecture for babies, but we can definitely adjust it. There were a couple people who had three-year-olds who want to talk about three-year-old sleep issues, and that's fine too. We'll kind of go through the talk. The talk usually lasts about 45 minutes or so, and then I'm totally happy to take questions afterwards. The other thing I let you know too is that I work in primary care at the West Valley site. I have a special interest in sleep, and so I do see children and families for sleep consultations as well. So if you're having like a particular issue, or you feel like you've talked about it with your pediatrician, or you've gotten lots of advice from everybody about it and it's just not working out and you just need a plan, sometimes you just need a plan of what to do, I'm also totally happy to see you. And the way you would do that is to just contact your pediatrician and they can just send me a little message if you go here. If not, you can also just call my office and make an appointment. Yeah. We can talk about teenagers too. So let me get a sense. We can talk about anything. We can talk about whatever we want. So who's here for a baby under 6 months? Okay, and that's usually the vibe here. Who's here for a baby 6 months to 2 years old? Okay. Who's here for a 2 to 5 year old? Okay. And I know there's some families who have like multiple hands going up, so I get that. Who's here for a 5 to 12 year old? Okay. So our 5 to 12 year olds are sleeping pretty well. And who's here for a 12 and up year old? Maybe one. Okay. So it's up to you. It's probably going to be pretty geared to the little kids. So if you want to stay, you can. If you want to go, I totally understand. Okay, perfect. So pretty much sounds like it's geared towards some preschool age, mostly two and under. I'm getting the vibe for. Okay, perfect. That's usually who comes to this, so that sounds good. All right, so just to give you a little bit of my background, I've been working here for about 5 years. I was at Kaiser for how long? 6 years before that. I started developing a special interest in sleep when I had my first child, who is now 8, and she was a horrible sleeper. And I just thought to myself, why is she such a bad sleeper? What am I doing wrong? Why is this so difficult? Why does this seem so hard? Why didn't I get that baby who you can just leave in the car seat and they're just quiet and they go to sleep? Why is that? And so I started just getting kind of interested in it, and I started reading all the books that are out there, started actually looking at the research, like what makes a good sleeper? What makes a lousy sleeper? Like what can you do to sort of, you know, get your child to be a good sleeper? You know, how does that all that work? What's the research on it? So I started getting kind of interested in it. And I got more and more interested in it because what I found is that when you look at the research and you look at the stuff that's been done and the books that have been written, there actually is a lot you can do to help your child be a good sleeper. And there's some pretty good studies out there and there's some pretty good techniques. And I think it's one of those things where there's very few areas of medicine where without medication and without surgery, you can actually make a big change in a whole family's health. So that's kind of how I got interested in this. I am not here to tell anybody to let their kids cry. That is not what this whole talk is all about. We will talk about crying. It is a technique, and we will talk about it. But there's a lot of other parts of this talk as well. I think it's helpful to understand where some of that advice to let your kids cry all night comes from, and we'll talk about it. Okay, so I am told I need to stand about here. Good? All right. So this is my third child. She is now almost 2. She is a good sleeper. And I think I have learned some things in this. So I show a picture of her sleeping to hopefully convince you that I did something right, because she is a good sleeper. Okay. Is this my button I'm supposed to push? Jeremy? No? Is this my button?
Right on the side.
On the side? This one? This little one?
No.
It's green now. It was red before. Sorry. That one? Oh, on the way, say get it. Okay, got it. Okay, so those are my 3 kids. And that's Gloria, my little one. And then that's the middle one, that's Delia, and she's the one who is a terrible sleeper. And that's Thomas, my middle one, who is a good sleeper too. And that's Thomas now. So, you know, we have learned a lot about sleep over the years, and so hopefully I can share some of that with you. Okay, so we're going to go through a couple of cases. This is somewhat related to babies, you know, but this is what I hear all day long in clinic. So my 6-month-old used to be such a good sleeper. We even thought he was going to start sleeping through the night. But then he caught a cold when he was 5 months, and he started waking up every 2 hours. Now I think he's teething. Nothing seems to settle him down at night, and sometimes we're up for hours at night. We're exhausted, and we don't know where to start. Or this one's a common one as well. It takes forever to get my baby down for the night. We've tried to have a bedtime routine. We nurse him and we rock him and we try and gently put him down, but if he wakes up, forget it. Start over and the whole routine can take hours. So this is another thing I hear a lot. Nobody's sleeping, not the baby, not either one of us. She gets up to eat 3 times per night. She's almost 1 year old. I don't know how much longer we can go on in this sleep-deprived state. I don't want to let her cry, but I don't know what else to do, and everything I try seems to make it worse. I'll put in here one for the 3-year-olds. My 3-year-old won't stay in bed. It takes forever to get him down to bed. He asks for 3 glasses of water, needs 100 bedtime stories. His 17 animals all kissed goodnight. And then he gets out of bed 100 times, and we bring him back to bed, but eventually we give up and he comes into bed with us, and I don't know how to get him out. That's a 3-year-old one. Okay, so good sleep habits can be taught to children. And we're going to just talk about some basics here first so that you get an idea of sort of where we're going. And we'll get into details and, like I said, happy to answer questions. So first we're going to talk about the physiology of sleep in infants and children because it helps to understand some of what the advice will be. Explain why babies and older children sometimes wake up frequently and don't return or can't return to sleep in the night. We're going to try and understand sleep associations and then discuss tools that you can use to make a new sleep plan for your family. So what is normal sleep? Nobody believes me when I tell them that a newborn sleeps 16 and a half hours in a 24-hour period. It does not feel like they do, because they do not sleep for any long period of time ever in a row. So it is actually true that if you take a stopwatch and you time it, they sleep that much. But they don't sleep for very long at a time. Usually, you know, they catnap. They do half an hour, they do an hour here, maybe once in a while they do 3 hours. But they're up a lot, and so you feel like nobody sleeps, but they do. So you can see the progression of this. What's always interesting to me as you go through this is that the typical 3-year-old should be sleeping about 13 hours in the 24-hour period. It's still a lot of sleep. I say what is normal sleep and what should they be doing, but there is a huge epidemic of sleep-deprived children. This just fell out. Sorry. is that okay? It's okay. There is definitely a huge epidemic of sleep-deprived children, and sleep-deprived babies, sleep-deprived older children, sleep-deprived teenagers for sure. But you know, this is really physiologically how much they should be sleeping. And sometimes people say to me, well, you know, my 3-year-old only sleeps, you know, 9 hours if you count it all up. They are not getting enough sleep. There is a very rare 3-year-old who is actually like a short sleeper that's a physiologic possibility, but it's not common. So that child probably has pretty bad sleep habits, I would guess. Okay, so in general, newborns sleep for erratic 2 to 3 hour blocks, if you're lucky. And by 4 months, you're starting to see a morning nap that's starting to emerge in terms of daytime sleep, and they're consolidating to 1 or 2 nighttime wakenings. Most babies in the little baby period, if you're here for an under 6-month-old, usually their best sleep, if they're gonna be a good sleeper, starts to evolve around 3 months or so, maybe 4 months. A lot of babies have a good sleep period, right around 3 or 4 months, and you think you're almost there. You're like, yeah, okay, we're getting there, we're gonna get through, they're gonna start sleeping through the night, and then it all like backfires on you, and they backtrack, and they start waking up again, and you're like, what happened? Like, what did I do? What happened? So we're gonna talk about that. By 6-month-olds, most babies are doing about 3 naps a day. Some babies are doing 2, and they're usually up once or maybe sleeping through. By 9 months, most babies are doing 2 naps a day and sleeping through the night. I'm saying in an ideal world. I know none of your babies are doing that. 12 to 18 months, 1 nap a day and sleeping through. And then by 3, most kids give up their nap. Some kids give up their nap a little bit earlier, a little bit later, depending. So that's kind of, you know, about what we see. Sometimes people say, okay, well, I have a 9-month-old and he wakes up once a night, he eats really quick and he goes back to sleep and it's fine. And I say, fine. Like, why are we talking about it? I mean, it's fine. If it's fine for you, it's fine for me. You know, that's okay. So there's some variation in this, but this is the average. So to talk a little bit about sleep cycles and sleep physiology, this helps you understand some of why babies wake up a lot at night, and older kids too. There's 2 main kinds of sleep. There's non-REM sleep here, and there's REM sleep. And in non-REM sleep, we can break that up into 4 different stages of sleep. So when you enter into sleep, basically you go through the different 4 stages of sleep. So you start in stage 1 sleep, which is light sleep. It doesn't last for very long, maybe 30 seconds to 5 minutes. Stage 2 sleep is the next. It's the initiation of true sleep. It lasts for 5 minutes to 25 minutes. That's the stage of sleep that you're in when you're falling asleep and you're laying in bed and you have that weird little dream that you're like stepping off a curb or you're stepping into a hole and you go like that. That's stage 2 sleep. So that's about when that happens. Stage 3 and stage 4 sleep are deep sleep or delta sleep. And kids and adults are the most difficult to awaken in that stage of sleep. So that's basically when like you get woken up because, you know, the fire alarm starts going off, or you know, you set your alarm to midnight when you forgot to change the time or whatever, and you're totally out of it and you're like, where am I and who am I and what country am I in? That's stage 4 sleep. REM sleep is different. It's a whole different kind of a stage of sleep, and it varies a lot in how much time we spend in REM sleep throughout childhood. It's very different than what adults do. So REM sleep, your muscles aren't really paralyzed. Like if you woke up, you would be able to move, obviously. But you have very little muscle tone. You have a high level of cortical activity. You dream in REM sleep, and you have these weird phasic eye movements. So if you've ever looked at your newborn and saw them with their eyes half open, and their eyes are flicking in the back of their head like this, and you're like, that's kind of creepy looking, that's REM sleep. Infants spend a ton of time in REM sleep. Nobody knows why, for sure. We think that that's because they're making all of these fabulous neurologic connections, and their brain is making all their synapses, and they're growing and developing, but nobody really knows. So they spend up to 50 to 60% of their time in a REM-like sleep. And unlike adults who go through all the phases of sleep first, newborns actually enter into REM sleep first. So they do all these funky things, these little jerks and twitches and eyes rolling back in their head and such. Adults usually go through the full cycle. They go through stage 1 through 4, and then they have a couple of minutes of REM sleep about every 90 minutes. So that's what we call the sleep cycle. You go stage 1 through 4, you do a little REM, you cycle around, and you come back. Infants usually cycle through the sleep states every 50 minutes or so, and that happens up until they're 6 months or so. So their sleep cycle is a little bit faster. They stop entering directly into REM when they're about 2-ish months old. So a 2-month-old actually has a really different sleep pattern if you look at them in a sleep study than a newborn does. You're like, why are you telling me all this? It actually is going to make sense. So most sleep cycles in infants, they go through the phases of sleep. They have kind of a longish REM period. And then as they come through the sleep cycle, often they end in a short arousal as they come into those lighter stages of sleep. That's stage 1 and stage 2. The short arousals happen, depending on the baby, every 60 if they're on the shorter side to every 90 if they're an older child, minutes in most infants. Many babies, if they do wake up in stage 1, they rustle around, and you might hear your kids doing that. They move and they wiggle, whatever. And then with a little bit of luck, they fall back to sleep on their own without you doing anything. That's what we hope for, okay? But some babies call out for reassurance during these wakenings. So when we talk about sleeping through the night, one really important concept is that nobody sleeps continuously all night. Babies don't, adults don't. We all have these brief wakenings all night long as we go through the sleep cycles. And so sleeping through the night for a baby has a lot less to do with actually staying asleep consistently through the whole night, and has more to do with a baby putting him or herself back to sleep. So one thing that often happens, and we're going to revisit this a couple times, and this is important for 3-year-olds, this is important for 3-month-olds, this is important for everybody, is how good is your baby at coming through the sleep cycle, briefly awakening, and being able to settle themselves back down to go to sleep. That's really, in the end, what makes a good sleeper. And that's why some babies are temperamentally just good sleepers. These are the super irritating people who have babies who sleep through the night when they're, what, 3 days old or something? I don't even know. I don't have any of those kids. But, you know, they talk to you, talk to your friends, and they're like, oh, yeah, it's no big deal, and whatever. I don't know why it's such a boom, you know? And you're like, okay, so you got this baby who just does this on their own. You didn't really have to do anything, and they just started doing it because they're good non-signalers, non-call-outers. I know how to settle myself, and I'm going to go back to sleep. So then we all ask ourselves, why don't I have that baby? So why does my baby not fall back to sleep? What did I do wrong? Well, that's what I do, but that's just a, you know, guilty mother thing, maybe. I don't know. So sleep associations are those things that your baby or older child has learned to associate with going to sleep. And sleep associations can be positive or negative. Now, one of the things that tends to happen, which is very normal, is you have a 3-month-old or a 4-month-old. They come through the sleep cycle, they wake up, and they cry. And your natural reaction, because you're all good parents, is to feed your baby, because you assume that they're hungry. Right? Normal, you would think. That's what we tell you to do when you come in the office. We're like, feed your baby. That's what you're supposed to do. And that's good, and most of the time that's great. One thing, though, is that when you start having a 6-month-old who eats every 2 hours, or a 9-month-old who eats every 2 hours, and I have people come in all the time with a, like, 25-pound 9-month-old, and I'm like, so probably not needing to eat every 2 hours. I'm just saying. I do have an MD, but still, you know. So at some point, there gets to be a difference between needing to eat every 2 hours and when they cry, wah, okay, pick them up and feed them, to realizing that they're signaling. Are they hungry? Maybe, maybe not, not really sure. That's when it starts getting into really bad sleep habits, and we're off. Is this like ringing true with anybody at all? Is this kind of making some sense? Okay, yeah. All right. So we're going to talk about sleep associations, because it's important in the sense that when babies do wake up, what we want them to do is really learn how to fall back asleep on their own, because that lets us sleep, and that's really, at the end of the day, important, because that's important for everybody's family's health. So positive sleep associations are independent falling asleep and returning to sleep after waking at night sort of habits. And that's what we're kind of looking for babies to learn how to do. So the key phrase that you'll read in lots of these books that Jeremy has over here is drowsy but awake. So it can be one of the most frustrating things that you read, but it does have a lot of validity to it. So the idea is that the last moments of falling asleep, and I'm talking about when you're putting your baby down for a nap, or an older baby going to sleep on, you know, on their own at night, or even an older kid going to sleep on their own at night, is they need to learn how to fall asleep on their own. Because when they learn that skill, they're then going to be able to when they wake up at night, replicate that whole process and fall back to sleep on their own. So I hear all the time people who are like, my three-year-old, I can't get him to go to sleep. I have to go in. I have to lay down with him. He lays there with me, and I lay there with him, and I have to like pat him on his head, and we have to sing songs and rub his back until he falls asleep. And then you sneak out of the room. And so that's okay. You know, you've gotten him to sleep. But then when you see that child wake up in the middle of the night, if they're still waking from those sleep cycles that they come through, then your issue then becomes, well, you kind of can't really expect him to fall back asleep on his own. He's like alone in a room, and your baby, and they don't know what to do because they're not having the same thing that they had from before, right? So in general, the earlier that you start encouraging drowsy but awake is the better, you know, but you can encourage it anytime. Okay, so positive sleep associations. What helps your baby get back to sleep without your presence being there? And we're going to talk about sort of the positive sleep associations first. So things that if you're not doing some of these things, these are some things that you might be able to introduce that help. So one thing that's great, I think, is a lovey, like a little blankie, a little stuffed animal, a little something that basically people call a transitional object. You know, it's basically something that you're having stand in for you. You can do this as young as 4 or 5 months is fine. Sometimes people ask me, aren't you supposed to have nothing in the crib? I think it's okay to have like a little tiny something is okay. Basically, the idea is whenever you're getting your baby or your older kid ready for bed, you have this little thing and you know you're snuggling with them and with it, and then they've got this little thing so that when they're alone, then they're snuggling it and they're feeling good and happy. So something that they can control on their own, like a music box or a mobile that they can turn on for themselves. So like there's the ones with the big, you know, you can put next to a bed if you have an older kid, or one that you can put like in the crib even that's got a big button on it that they can hit themselves. So something where they can be like, oh, I'm awake, oh, I'm gonna hit my thing, oh, my sleepy music's on, okay, I'm gonna go back to sleep. So something that you can build a new association with for something that they can learn that means that they can go back to sleep. For older kids, you know, a sippy cup of water that they can get for themselves. You don't need to have the, I need a cup of water for an older kid all night long, giving them some tools to be able to handle some of that themselves. People ask me about pacifiers all the time. A pacifier, for me, I think is okay. You know, I think that, you know, by a lot of times 7 months or 8 months, they can actually grab them themselves if they fall out. So I have no problem with leaving 5 or 6 pacifiers around the crib so they can grab one and pop it back in if that's something that helps them get back to sleep. Or a thumb. Thumb suckers are the best sleepers ever because they're like, oh, and then they go back to sleep. It's always attached. It's always there. So these are just examples of things that they can do for themselves. The key is they do it for themselves. It's not you doing it for them, okay? So negative sleep associations are sort of the flip side of that. Those are things that they're not negative in and of themselves. It's just that it's requiring you to do it for them. So rather than having them be able to soothe themselves to sleep, these are things that you are doing to soothe them to sleep, which is all fine and good and feels like the right thing to do, but in the end, it's sort of not allowing them always to, you know, put themselves to sleep. So basically, it's something that requires parental intervention to provide it. And again, they're not negative activities all the time, just when they're required to achieve sleep. So really, again, that message is, in order to improve the sleep, they have to be able to put themselves to sleep without parents doing it for them. So I've heard everything in the whole world of negative sleep associations, I think, at this point. Maybe you guys have some new ones for me. But common ones are rocking in motion. So this is like the baby who at 6 weeks old, you could rock them for a few minutes and they fall asleep, and then you're like, oh, and you put them in the crib and they're asleep, and you're like, oh, don't wake up, and you're trying to sneak out of the room. So that's good at 6 weeks because it still kind of works, but by 4 months or 6 months or 9 months, you're like, oh, I have this huge baby, and I'm like walking up and down the halls with this huge, heavy baby, and it doesn't really work that well anyway. And as soon as they start waking up, the whole thing starts over again, and it's like a nightmare, right? So that's a big one. Nursing is a huge one. Obviously, a fan of nursing, it's good. Love nursing, it's good. But when the only way a baby can go to sleep is when they are nursing, that's an issue. It's an association that is really entrenched, right? Right? Anybody nodding? I see a lot of nodding. Yeah, I know, it's a really hard one. But here's the thing. You have to get into the baby's head and be like, well, why shouldn't I be able to do that? That's all I've ever done my whole life is fall asleep while I was nursing. So sometimes it's like habits have to change. So pacifiers, again. So pacifier can be negative, can be positive, depending on how it goes. The walking up and down the hall till they fall asleep on your shoulder. So, okay. Crazy ones, twirling their mom's hair like this until they fall asleep. I've had sucking on mom's fingers, baby's fingers, and the parents' mouths. That, I mean, crazy, goes on and on and on. Not to be judgmental, but like, I've heard it all. So these sleep associations, they don't have to be one specific thing. They can be a big variety of things, but they really get entrenched and they're hard to break. So from your baby's point of view, I was warm and cozy and being nursed or being rocked or being shushed or being swung or all the four S's or all that stuff, right, that you guys are doing. And then now I'm in my crib somehow. I don't know how I got here. I'm awake. I have no food. I have no mom. I don't know how I got here. I have never fallen asleep before by myself and I need some help. So what do they do? Wee! Wee! And then you think they're hungry, so you go feed them. Right? Okay. That's my crazy kids. All right, so how can my baby sleep better? So we're gonna get back to some of the associations and how to sort of teach babies some better habits, but we're gonna go through a few things that you can do first as well. And see, I always believe that before you get into the really hardcore, like what are we really gonna have to do here in order to get your babies to sleep better, try some of these things that aren't so hard first and see if it makes a difference. So the first thing is increasing the number of sleep hours if your baby is overtired. Most babies who are having sleep problems are overtired. I can't emphasize that enough. It sounds really crazy and counterintuitive, but the more babies sleep, the more the babies sleep. People say all the time, like when they come finally, like if they come see me and I do a sleep consultation and we do a schedule and we make a plan, people are like, that's crazy. Like my kid can never sleep that much. But once they get settled and once they get started, it's like they sleep longer and longer for naps, they sleep longer and longer at night. It's like this, I don't know exactly why, I don't know medically why, but it just happens. Better sleep brings on better sleep. So one of the things to start with is just knowing how much they need to sleep and starting to think about that. So we'll talk a little bit about creating a sleep conducive environment and a consistent short nighttime routine, because I think that helps sometimes. Increasing the positive associations and eliminating the negative associations. How are we doing for time? Okay, so the universal wisdom is there are many methods of breaking the negative sleep associations like we talked about, and we will get back to this too, but every book that you read, every book that Jeremy has out there, every book you can get at the library or on Amazon, whether it's the hardcore cry it out people or the no cry sleep solution, it all comes down to, for every single age group, breaking the negative sleep associations. That's it. That's the whole thing. Because almost every poor sleeper has trouble with it to some degree. So the independent falling asleep is key. All right, so in general, a 6-month-old needs to be sleeping 10 to 12 hours at night with perhaps one nighttime awakening, maybe, but usually none, and taking 1 to 2 hour naps a day, in general. It's pretty unusual for a baby at this age actually to need less sleep than this, okay? Again, tired babies do not sleep well, sleep brings on sleep, and babies who don't sleep well are overtired and stressed and overstimulated when they're going down to sleep. Overtired babies, we know, actually go through the sleep cycle faster and they have more awakenings during the lighter stages of sleep. So poor sleeping brings on poor sleep. We know that. They wake up more often if they don't sleep well during the day, and vice versa. They don't nap when they don't sleep well at night. So this is just a sleep sample schedule, and this is, I know there's a lot of different age groups here. This is a sample for a 6-month-old. Like I said, if you want to come see me in clinic, we can do whatever your child's age is. But most kids at 6 months old need to be napping at most 90 minutes from the time that they wake up, usually better closer to 60 minutes, and they need to be napping again no later than after 2 or 3 hours of wakefulness. So they might even need a third or fourth nap at the end of the day, especially as they're catching up on their sleep. And sometimes they need to be asleep for bed as early as 6 or 6:30 p.m. People look at me like I am insane when I say that babies need to go to sleep at 6 o'clock at night. So I know it sounds crazy, but babies generally fall into better sleep patterns a little bit easier when you start putting them to bed a little bit earlier. I don't know why. 6 to 7 is a good time to aim for. So again, this is just sort of looking at it in like this format. Say they get up at 6:30 at night, and I know that's not everybody, some babies get up late, it's just a sample. Down at 8 for a nap and up at 9, down at 11 again and up at 12:30, down at 2:30 and up at 3:15, and then down for the night at 6. That's a lot of sleep, right, for a baby. So a lot of times when I help people make up a schedule, like I said, people are like, there's no way my baby's going to do that. But once you're consistent and once you stick with it, one of the keys with this is consistency. If you wait for the baby or the child to tell you that they're tired, if you wait until they're crying and fussy and miserable, you've missed the boat, you've missed the window. They don't fall asleep easily, especially on their own, if they're really overtired. So especially at the beginning, if you're deciding to establish some kind of a routine like this, you know, you don't want to wait that long. It's actually better to watch the clock a little bit and be like, okay, they've been up for this long, I think it's about the time. And even if they don't look tired, you want to catch the window of when they're going to be easiest to fall asleep and get them down. So, you know, sometimes it happens predictably at a given interval from the last time that they slept. But again, a happy, well-rested baby is a lot more likely to fall asleep and stay asleep than an overtired baby. So for a 12-month-old, this is sort of, again, just a little, you know, 6:30 wake up, maybe a morning nap at 8:30, an afternoon nap at 7:30, and a 7 o'clock bedtime. That's kind of the average. So people ask me all the time, and we live in a crazy area where nobody gets home from work until who knows when, you know, how can I put my baby to bed at 6 o'clock when dad doesn't even get home, or mom, or whoever, until 7 o'clock? And, you know, sometimes once you get this schedule established, a lot of times it doesn't have to be forever. Sometimes once they're actually sleeping well, they get a little bit more flexible, especially once they're sleeping through the night. So you can have a special occasion where you're up a little bit later, you'd go out to dinner or whatever, and they can handle it because you've got a schedule at least for them to go back to. You know, dad time might have to be in the morning for a while. But also, there's some serious benefit to having parent alone time. And this is just two words on this, is if you put your kids to bed early and you can have a little bit of time by yourself in the evening, it's actually really good for everybody. That's just a little aside, totally non-medical advice. But really, it's really, really hard to have little kids. And they're exhausting and they drive you nuts. And so I love my kids, but I mean, right? Yes? So I think there's a sanity issue here too as well. It is okay to have a bedtime and say it is bedtime and everybody needs to go to bed and I need a little break. It's fine, it's really fine. Okay, so pretty much almost every family I've ever advised has benefited by moving their baby's bedtime earlier by 1 or 2 hours, especially the kids 6 to 12 months. So just something to think about. Okay, so again, important points to review. Don't wait until your baby is fussy before you put them down because they're too tired. They're not gonna fall asleep, okay? Fussy babies are almost always tired babies, and especially babies who don't sleep well at night. And waiting to put your baby down because he's not tired, especially they're happy and they're whatever, it's gonna ensure a lousy nap or a night's sleep. Those are my crazy kids again. They're big now, they're 8 and 7. Okay, so bedtime routines. Most people who are having sleep problems are already doing bedtime routines. You know, most people have kind of got this down already, but we'll just go over it quickly. It is never too early to start a bedtime routine. I think that keeping it short makes a lot of sense, especially as the kids get older, 2, 3, 4-year-olds. The bedtime routine can be ridiculously long. It's like an hour long and you're reading 100 books and all. You don't need to do that. I mean, even if over some time you need to pare it down a little bit, keep it short. 15 to 20 minutes is fine. It doesn't really matter what it is, as long as it's the same each night. I think it works the best if it's in their baby or kid's room, but you can do it wherever. Like bath, book, little massage, lights out. And now here's this back to this concept, down to sleep, drowsy but awake. So a lot of times part of the regular bedtime that you have, you know, for your baby or older kid even, is you're rocking or you're walking or you're patting, or for littler babies you're feeding until they're totally asleep and then you're putting them down. It is a good time, any time now, for any age baby to stop doing that. So in terms of sleep environment, I think it's a good idea to associate your child's sleep with a dark, quiet room, in general. People sometimes ask me, well, shouldn't they be flexible? Shouldn't they be able to sleep wherever? Shouldn't I be able to put them down in a loud, noisy house and have them sleep and have them get used to that? If that works for you, you should go for it. I have never heard that work for anybody, actually, because kids just don't really sleep well when it's noisy and light, I don't think. So I think having a place where they know it's sleep time in a consistent environment, I think works really well. I like blackout blinds, nap time, you pull them down, it's dark and it's quiet. You know, when you have older kids especially, I say quiet, you do the best you can. You can try and send the other ones outside, or, you know, for nap time especially, do your best. Sometimes quiet works if, you know, sometimes people live in places which are really noisy, if you've got neighbors who are really close. You can use like a white noise machine. Some people do like a radio turned to static, a laptop that's plugged in. People do sometimes the hum, I don't know. You can try anything. like we were talking about, some music that your baby can control themselves. But the point is, anything that you're doing when you're putting them down, you want it to be fairly consistent. So you want it to be something that, like, let's say you go to grandma's house, you want to be able to bring it with you, because then they're not going to sleep, right? So, you know, if you've got, like, your little music box and it's portable and you can bring it, that's good. So some babies, when I talk to families, or some older kids, have grown into this, like, terrorized, like, thing with the crib. Like, they're so terrorized because they've screamed in there, or their parents haven't ever wanted to put them in there, and they see the crib and they start screaming. It's just like, oh, this drama about the crib. So if that has become a site of terror, you can also kind of desensitize them to the crib a little bit and just let them play in there a little. Helps. So pick a good happy time of day. Morning is good. Let your baby just hang out and play in there a little bit. And the other thing I think is important is if you're getting them sleeping in the crib, which some people may not be, and that's fine, you know, maybe don't immediately pick them up. You know, put away some laundry, do a few things, let them know it's, like, okay to be in the crib. Like, nothing bad is going to happen if they're just hanging out in there for a couple of minutes. All right. That's Thomas. That's my middle one. Okay. So positive sleep associations, we talked about some of these, so I'll go through them again fairly quickly just to remind you. So anything or any situation that a baby can independently use to get to sleep. So loveys, we talked about, transitional objects. You can try with almost anything. There are some babies who will never adopt one no matter what you do. You can try and try and try. Some people, our children, like my oldest child, adopted a twin-sized Afghan that we had to bring with us everywhere, and still do, actually. So you don't really get to choose it always, but, you know. Try and just be consistent with it. Have it around a lot at bedtime. It helps. This one is one on somebody's head. Soft blankie, teddy, a part of mom's nightgown, especially for littler babies, if it smells like mom, sometimes that helps. So every time you nurse or snuggle for littler babies, bring the lovey along and always have it as your baby's drifting off to sleep. One just little mom clue there. If your baby really likes one, just get a couple more where they still make them in case you lose it. Okay. Consider some soothing music that the baby can turn on. We talked about pacifiers already. This phase, if you have a 3 or 4 year old, it does not last forever. I'm just letting you know. It does go away. My daughter now will only wear brown and black. Okay. So here's all the stuff that we already talked about, the night feedings, the rocking, the walking, the pacifier hound, the back rubbing, the shushing, the swaddling, and the sleeping in the swing. All this stuff that you're like, how did all this happen to me? How did I get trapped in all of this? And I can't get my baby to sleep otherwise. This is the stuff I talk about every day with my patients. So basically, you know, we'll talk about feedings first, but then we'll talk about how to get rid of some of the other ones. So can I just get a show of hands before I spend time on this? How many babies are feeding a lot at night? Okay, so good enough percentage. Okay. So it's a pretty rare baby over 6 months who needs to eat overnight. I know that that is, like, heresy to say, and that is, like, for breastfeeding advocates in particular, like, if you've ever seen a lactation consultant, do not film this for the lactation consultants. They will say, feed your baby at night forever, okay? Like, I totally get that. It's really nutritionally rare for babies to need to eat overnight at 6 months. They're big. They're not newborns. They don't need to eat every 2 hours. Maybe once for a skinny baby, but probably not, okay? So especially babies at 6 months who are eating every 2 hours, no. Now, that said, babies who do eat overnight in that pattern, they eat heartily. They eat hungrily. If you drew a bottle or if you nurse, they suck it down. They will suck down those 4 ounces and look at you like, where is the rest of it? So it's not so much that they have to be eating, but they're conditioned to eat a lot at night because they're used to it and they've been doing this for their whole lives. If I drank a glass of milk every night at 2 a.m. for 3 or 4 months, when the next night I woke up at 2 a.m., I would be hungry. Your body gets used to it. Do you know what I'm saying? So they're conditioned and they are hungry, but it doesn't mean they have to eat at those times. So you can change your baby's hunger cycles so that they really do receive all the needed calories during the daylight hours. And then when your baby's no longer eating in the night, you probably will feel better about eliminating some of the other negative associations, and we can talk about that. There's a couple different ways to do this. You can work on eliminating them at the same time as doing everything else, which is sort of like the cold turkey method, and we'll talk about that. I just feel like if your baby's nursing more than 3 times a night, or drinking more than 2 4- to 6-ounce bottles at night, or routinely soaking through diapers in the night, you're probably going to want to first, as you work on the sleep, wean down the amount they're eating before you work on the rest of it. I know it's very intertwined. I know it's very hard to, it's very easy to say that and very hard to do it. But, you know, you might want to try and, if you can, bring down the volume a little bit to see if you can do that first, because I am not even so mean as to totally cut them off. I am pretty mean, as you will find pretty soon. Okay, so strategy number one, nurse for fewer minutes or decrease the ounces per bottle for each night feeding a little bit at a time. You know, this is not rocket science, a little bit over the course of a week or so. Strategy two, if they're bottle fed, you can consider slowly watering down the formula. This is for babies 6 months and over. Do not do this with a little tiny baby. This is not good for little tiny babies, 6 months and up, okay? Until there's nothing left but water. It might continue the association with the bottle, but at least you know that they're not really hungry. I would say I would only consider this solution if your baby can get a bottle of water for himself. You know, so like if this is something that they really love to have and suck on and that helps them go to sleep, if you can kind of teach them that there's a bottle of water over there and they can suck on it and put themselves to sleep, maybe that's okay. You know, we always talk about getting rid of the bottles and stuff, and I know we talk about that a lot, but if they have a bottle of water, nothing bad's gonna happen to their teeth. It's really the milk in there. Okay. So getting babies to fall asleep on their own, sort of the why we want you to do this, and we've talked some about this, and then the hows. So one question that people ask me a lot is, okay, so we've talked about all these negative sleep associations. I'm totally on board. They're bad. I get it. So what happens if we do nothing? Like, when are they going to get better from this? Like, aren't they going to grow out of it? You know, what if I just wait? Wait until the baby's 9 months or 12 months or whatever, 3 or 4. Is this just going to get better? So we'll talk about that. What are the options of how to fix it? What works? What doesn't? And then if I let my baby cry, will I damage him forever? Which is really what people want to know too. Okay. So we're going to talk about first like the longer term outcomes of some of these sleep issues. So what if my baby wakes up and can't get back to sleep? She'll outgrow it eventually. So there's a few studies. There's some pretty good data on this, that this is actually something that often lasts and lasts. So about 1,700 children in Quebec were followed for 3 years. And I'm always amazed by this study still every time I talk about it. Of the children who did not sleep 6 consecutive hours at 5 months, still a third were not sleeping 6 consecutive hours by 29 months of age. That's 2.5 years old. So that's, you know, two-thirds were, but still a third weren't. That's a big chunk of kids who are still not sleeping very well. The parental presence at sleep onset was the factor most strongly associated with not sleeping at least 6 hours consecutively at 17 or 29 months of age. That's when you are there padding, there rocking, there doing, whatever. That's what makes them not sleep well. That's a good study, because it was pretty well done. Okay, this is a smaller study for sure. 60 normal children just followed from 15 months to 3 years. So of the 25 children who were defined as having sleep disturbances at 15 months, defined as bedtime struggle, nighttime wakenings, or both, 84% still had persistence of these sleep disturbances at 3 years. A smaller study for sure, but it was nice because it was a prospective study. You start with a certain group and then you watch it over time. You know, point being that if you're still having issues at 15 months, you're probably still gonna have issues at three. So there's some good reason to work on it, you know? One more. This is a parental questionnaire, which is always, especially for sleep-deprived parents, a little unreliable. We'll give you that. But so they looked at 472 children who were old, age 4 to 10. Sleep problems were really common. I mean, that's something that is remarkable to me, but I believe it. 10 to 20% of children, all children, 4 to 10 years old have sleep problems. And the largest single predictor of sleep problems in the school age years was onset of sleep problems before 2 years. So again, some fairly good evidence showing that it's something you might want to work on now. So this is when we get to this point, you know, how do I eliminate negative sleep associations? When I don't help my baby get to sleep, she cries, and I can't take it, and I go in, and I pick her up, but then we're right back to where we started from. And I hate drowsy but awake. My baby sure isn't drowsy when she hits the crib. So we've been there. We've all been there. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about, okay, so I get the problem. I understand why it happens. I get it that I should maybe work on it. You know, what can I do? So what should I do? Let me, before I even get into this, to tell you, I am not here to tell you to do anything. Do whatever you want. I don't have to sleep at your house. I don't have to be up with your baby all night. The point is this, if you are happy with how your child is sleeping, that's fine. You know, I think that what this talk should hopefully get you to is either I'm going to take some intervention and do something about it, or I'm not, and I'm going to understand that it's not really going to get better for a while. Do you know what I mean? It's just like having the correct expectations of where this is going. Okay, so we're going to talk about some cry it out. And like I said, I'm not telling you to do it. I'm just giving you the information, so don't. Okay. So cry it out, or CIO, on parenting websites, if you read those. There's a lot of different versions of extinction, which is cry it out methods, and we'll go through all of them. The bottom line is it doesn't make that much difference how you do it if you're consistent, and we'll talk about that. So unmodified extinction is basically you take your baby or older child or whoever, you can do this up until 4 or 5 years old for sure, with different slight techniques. You basically take your baby, you put them in a room, and you don't respond to them crying unless you feel like the baby is having a risk to their health. And you say, night, night, I'll see you in the morning. That's it. I don't care how much you cry, doesn't matter, I'll see you in the morning. So that's unmodified extinction. That's like the hardcore stuff. Okay, graduated extinction. This is putting baby to sleep and then checking on the baby at regular or lengthening intervals until the baby falls asleep on his own after a lot of crying. So this is the Ferber method. So if you heard of Ferber, Ferber's the famous sleep guy. So this is his thing. And you can pick, you can read the Ferber book if you want. You can pick any amount of time. You can check after 5 minutes. You can check after 15 minutes. You can check after 3.5 minutes. You can do whatever you want. It doesn't matter. They've studied it well. The minutes don't matter. The checking is for you. The checking is not for the baby. Okay. The theory with this is that I think the reason that sometimes people go for this instead of the unmodified extinction is because, number one, people cannot stay out of the room. You just cannot. And secondly, people think that maybe by seeing you, it's going to make the baby feel more secure and like everything's all good and things are okay. When I tried this, personal story, tried this with my daughter, she would see me. And she'd be like, ah! And she'd see me. And she'd be like, I'd be like, it's okay, it's okay. And then I would go out of the room. And she'd be like, what? Like, what's that all about, right? Like, why is that helping me? So I think it just depends. Extinction with parental presence. And this is when you put the baby to sleep or the child to sleep. And you leave them there until they fall asleep, but you stay in the room and you say gentle things, or you try and avoid touching them or physically soothing the baby. This I actually recommend a lot for older kids. I think that there are, above two, if they're out of a crib, I do recommend this for some kids, especially if they are really freaked out by the crib. One thing I'm just going to tell you, and again, not telling you what to do, it is way easier to fix this problem at 4 to 6 months than it is to fix it at 3. Because at the end of the day, it's still the same problem. In the end, a lot of it is still the same problem. And fixing it at 4 to 6 months, it is quick, usually, pretty quick. Doing it at 3, it's harder. It's harder because they're so entrenched in the habits, and they're so entrenched with needing you at night, and there's so much drama, and you feel so, so bad, and they're really, really scared of being by themselves. It's just super hard. So this one, there's a good book on this one, and it's called like The Sleep Lady's Guide to Good Sleep or something. I don't remember. You can find it if you search for extinction with parental presence. But basically the idea is you have them go to sleep in their bed, you sleep next to them, and then you slowly move yourself out of the room a little bit at a time. People do this with littler babies. People do this with 6-month-old, 9-month-olds, whatever, and it works. It's slow. It works a lot slower than the whole like total cut them off sort of thing. But for some older kids, it can work. You know, I think that it's something where they just need to see you there for a while and not get so, so, so freaked out. So basically with extinction, the key concept is that you're putting them down drowsy but awake, so they're still a little bit awake. We're teaching them how to fall asleep by themselves so they know how to replicate that in the middle of the night when they wake up through the sleep cycle, right? But you want them to fall asleep on their own, but because they're not used to it, they're not going to fall asleep. They're going to start crying. They're going to start screaming. So extinction in the psychological sort of terminology, it's a system of ignoring your baby's crying until he falls asleep. And then you're undoing the association with needing the parental intervention to fall asleep. It's teaching them, so the crying it out methods, the extinction methods, are not actually about crying per se. The crying has a purpose. It's not just to let them cry. It's so they're learning, they're protesting when they're crying, but eventually that they learn how to have the independent habit to fall asleep on their own. So how long will my baby cry? It depends. It really depends. there are some babies who I think are going to be so hard, and then they're not. There's some babies who I think are going to be super easy, and then they're not. This is average, and this is not based on any study. This is just based on my whatever, like what I see. About an hour and a half the first night, some less. 30 to 45 minutes the second night, 10 to 15 minutes thereafter. A lot of babies continue to cry 5 or 10 minutes and fuss more than like, but you know, they just fuss 5 or 10 minutes before they fall asleep for a long time. Some don't. This is average for like a 6-month-old, 5, 6, 7-month-old. It takes about 3-4 nights. So people are always like, really? 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 But really, it's about 3 or 4 nights. About. The older they get, the longer it takes. A 9-month-old starts developmentally to understand separation. They understand when you leave the room, where you're going, and that you're not really there. Some of this, if you do it earlier, it does take advantage of the fact that they're not so developmentally like with you yet, and you can sort of cut it off. How long does it take? Well, yeah, like I said, modified and unmodified extinction usually work in about four or five days, I would say. It's usually 3. I put, just to be safe, 4 to 5. First and second nights are the worst. Parental presence takes a lot longer, usually several weeks. There's another couple of things you can try. There's something called scheduled awakenings, which there are some studies about. The idea of this is that if you wake your baby 20 or 30 minutes before he or she normally wakes up, and then you slowly decrease the number of times you wake them up, that sometimes it works. It probably works best for babies who wake regularly 1 or 2 times a night. There's a little bit of literature saying that for older kids, maybe this is a reasonable strategy. I personally can't picture myself waking myself up to go wake up my child before they would wake up, but I'm telling you all the information. Here it is. You may Google it and learn more about this on your own. I don't know very much about it, but there is some literature on this. There's also good literature on some of the nighttime routine stuff that we talked about. If you're not doing that, sometimes doing that actually does help things pretty considerably. There's also a book, I think it's over there, yeah, it's over there, called The No Cry Sleep Solution. Which, I don't know if anybody has it. Anybody have it yet? No? Yeah. It's decent for a read. If you get to the crux of it, the message is still the same. This is how do you get your baby to break the negative sleep association but still not cry. If you co-sleep and want to keep co-sleeping, and that's your choice, it's not a bad read for you. I think that people ask me sometimes about co-sleeping and does that make sense and is that okay? You know, and I have to tell you the official thing is don't do it, blah, blah, blah. But I'm also very open to the fact that like 90% of the world co-sleeps and we don't, and it's not to say who's right and who's wrong. I think that co-sleeping babies wake up a lot. I think that's just normal. That's what happens. So this is if you're trying to get a co-sleeping baby, especially to stop eating every half hour, and nursing especially, it's not a bad read. It helps a little bit. It's not going to solve your problems. I'm not sure the solution word should be in that book title, but it helps a little. So this is basically a little chart just so you see what some of the books are that are out there that you can get kind of more, you know, detailed information on all of these. So for the unmodified extinction, which is like the super hardcore, like put them in the room, don't get them, that is the Healthy Sleep Habits, Healthy Child book, and that's by Mark Weisbluth. It's a really popular one. It's super thick. It's really dense. I find it kind of difficult to get through, to be honest. Graduated extinction, that's the checking, cry it out method. That's the Ferber, solve your child's sleep problems. Take charge of your child's sleep, which is by Jody Mindell, which I think is over there too. There's a sleep easy guide, which is written by like these two sleep consultants to the stars. It's all the same stuff. It's the same thing. Extinction with parental presence, that's the Good Night Sleep Tight book. Again, crying it out but staying in the room. And then the scheduled awakenings, which there's no books about that I know of. And then the no cry. So it's sort of like more cry it out to less cry it out. So there's lots of options of ways that you can work on it. So what works? Probably the best two papers that have ever been done on this are reviews that have summarized 52 studies on infant sleep training, infant and child sleep training, I should say. And there's the reference for it there, and you certainly can look it up for both of them. This is basically a good summary of every piece of data that's been out there. What's great about this, I love these papers, because there's really good advice that and evidence that any intervention is better than nothing. Working on it helps. It helps. Everything helps a little bit. There's excellent advice that unmodified extinction, extinction with parental presence, and parental education pre-problem. This is like when you take your prenatal class and they're like, do this. Don't rock that baby to sleep. So that works. There's good evidence that graduated extinction and scheduled awakenings work. So everything works a little bit if you work on it. So which method should you choose? There's pros and cons to everything. I think that, like we talked about, how does your baby respond to you during checking or presence? Some babies are more worked up by checking than if they're left alone. there's some people who live in house situations where you can't let your baby scream. You know, you're going to wake up the whole neighborhood. You know, you're right next to somebody else. You know, will crying at night disrupt the whole apartment building or older siblings? Do you want everybody, I mean, training, like if you've got a three-year-old and a one-year-old and they both are lousy sleepers, you've got a problem because you can't let anybody cry because everybody's going to wake everybody else up. And there's stuff you can do for that, but there it is. There is some evidence that if you have your baby fall asleep unassisted once a day at nighttime or your older child, it might be all you need. Within 2 weeks, there's some studies that show that babies are sleeping better through the night. You would assume because they're learning that ability to fall asleep alone and it carries over to the nighttime wakings. So for example, like if you've got a one-year-old who is up a couple times a night, but you teach them to go to sleep on their own at least once during the 24-hour period, and then you give it some time and you keep getting them during the night, maybe they get a little bit better. Maybe it's kind of slow. So can you listen to your baby cry? Really, at the end of the day, for babies, kids up to 2 years old, can you listen to your baby cry? That is really what you need to ask yourself if it's the right thing for you and your family. I am not here to judge you. I am not here to be judgmental. Like I said, I do not have to sleep at your house. I think that if you're baby is really firmly entrenched in a negative association situation, crying could be an answer for you, but maybe not. It is not the right answer for everybody. I think that one thing that I tell everybody who comes to see me for a sleep consult is, if you want to do this, you have to do it. You can't kind of do it. You can't a little bit do it. You can't let them cry for 20 minutes and then go get them crying yourself. You cannot cry outside the door. It's not gonna work. It's one of those things like, you know, do I have another slide on this? No. I think it's really important though. If you kind of do it, you will make it worse. It won't even just not change. It will get worse. It's sort of like if you go and play slots and you win one out of every 20 times. If your baby gets picked up when they're crying one out of every 20 times, they're gonna keep playing. You know what I mean? They're like, ah! There's a possibility here that somebody's gonna come get me. So they know. It's sort of that concept, is it a wall or is it a wall with a door in it? You know? So consistency is super important. So either do it or don't do it. Own it. If you're gonna do it, I often recommend to people too, figure out who in the house can do it. Who cannot do it? Send the person who cannot do it away because they're not gonna help. I'm just saying. Okay? There's usually one person who can do it, and there's usually one person who can't. And if you can't, then own the fact that you can't. It doesn't mean that you're a bad parent or a weak parent. It just means that you can't do this one thing. It's really hard. I was a cry outside the door person. I had to be like, I gotta go. I gotta go to Starbucks. I gotta go do something by myself. And you know, it's okay. But what I would say is, if you kind of do it, it will not just make it not work, it will just make it worse. Because they learn that the longer that they cry, you're gonna get them. I know, it stinks, right? But there it is. Okay, so what else? Nobody likes to listen to babies cry, not even Dr. Ferber. And he's nice, actually. I've met him, and he's nice. He is, he's really like, he's actually kind of like sad that like his name is associated with all this, like, he's the head of the sleep disorders clinic at Boston Children's Hospital. I train there. And he's like such a nice man. And I mean, you wouldn't think of it with him. I mean, he really wants to help people in the end. Anyway, a little aside there. So consider that the need for sleep that your baby's not getting, and then consider that your baby can't learn to sleep without your help. Sometimes I feel like it's one of the hardest first things that you really have to teach them that they don't want to do. Consider the potential benefit to your baby and your own health, and I think this is important too. I see so many crazy sleep deprived people in my clinic for sleep consults. I look at these parents sometimes and I'm like, holy cow, you guys need to get some sleep. You lose all your sense when you don't sleep. And you know, a lot of people have not slept for a year or longer. And you really lose your ability to make good decisions. I'm just saying. So, you know, if you look at it from that direction, sleep is not just a baby health issue. Sleep is a family issue. You know, sleep is a whole family health issue. So, you know, if you're even considering working on this, I would encourage it. So acknowledge that this may be the hardest thing that you have yet to accomplish as a parent. It's really hard. So this is the big question everybody wants to know too, which is, will I break my child if I do this? Will I break my child forever? Will they end up depressed and not attached to me and in therapy later on? I'm sure all my children will be for other reasons too. There's not a lot of studies on this, I'm just telling you. There's some small studies that look at short-term outcomes. There, as far as I can read it, there are no studies that have been done on a long-term basis, so long-term follow-up, that show any psychological damage from doing crying it out. It doesn't mean, I guess, you know, possibly, could it be? You can imagine, it's a really, really hard study to do, right? I mean, how are you gonna control for all the variables? How are you gonna control, like, how long they cried? If you start looking at websites, there's very, very passionate people on the internet who say not to do this. And I respect them. It's fine. What their basis for all of that is that studies have been done that show that babies who cry a lot and they have had their blood sampled have higher levels of cortisol, which is a stress hormone. And they have taken that piece of data. Those studies were done not when babies were crying it out to go to sleep, but babies who were having usually painful procedures in an intensive care unit at some point. So fine. They take that and they say cortisol is a poisonous stress hormone and that's going to affect their brain development later on. So maybe, I guess. I have a hard time medically, scientifically making those jumps, you know, from one thing to another. But there haven't been great studies saying I'm going to let my kid cry it out at 6 months, and then when I look at them when they're 18 to 20 years old, do they have a higher chance of anxiety? You know, how do you do that study? I don't know. So there have been short-term studies. This is one that was done with 35 infants aged 6 to 24 months who were treated with extinction, like the hardcore extinction. There were no detrimental effects noted for those infants. It's basically a study where they did psychological scores looking at security, emotionality, tension, and likability, and they all actually improved after training. All the stuff's on here if you want to look them up. This is when 95 families participated in a sleep extinction program for their 4 to 45 month old child. Again, old kids, almost 4. Before intervention, the sleep disturbed children were rated as more insecure than controls. After intervention, this difference disappeared. Overall scores for family well-being and daytime behavior problems also improved. I will say anecdotally, I have not done studies on my own patients. I think that this is true. I think that when you get your children better sleeping, they are happier, they are more even-keeled, their behavior chills out, they're less temperamental, especially your 3 and 4 year olds. They throw less tantrums. And it's just from getting better sleep. It's just from getting more sleep. So like I said, I can't find any studies that actually have negative outcomes. It doesn't mean that the greatest studies in the world have been done, but there aren't any studies out there right now. And we talked about the cortisol stuff. Just briefly want to mention, if you do decide at some point to go ahead with a cry it out method, there is this weird psychological phenomenon called an extinction burst, which happens for a lot of kind of training programs. It can happen anywhere from night 2 to night 7 to 10, where like you think everything's great, they stop waking up, they're doing fabulous, and then they have like 1 or 2 nights where they just totally backtrack and freak out and start crying again. And we don't really know why it happens, but usually if you're consistent and you don't respond, it's about 1 or 2 nights and it goes away. So these are all the books that I talked about. And there's more out there. These are the base. There's not that many. These are kind of most of them. So have hope. All children can improve their sleep habits. You can make a huge difference. And thank you. So that's football. Time is it? 8. OK, good. I'm totally happy to answer any questions. What I usually ask is if you have a question that you feel like is fairly generalizable, I don't know. Applicable to everybody, go for it. If you think it's a really specific thing that's maybe a unique situation, I don't mind talking to you after as well. So, questions? Oh, lots of questions, yeah.
So once you sleep train them and you know, in a good place, if they get sick or they're teething, do you still ignore their nighttime crying or do you go in and then you start from scratch again?
It's a great question. So the question is, for anybody who didn't hear, so let's say you sleep train them, they're doing great, and then something happens. They get sick, they start teething, and they start waking up at night. What do you do? Do you ignore them or do you go back in again and you have to start all over? So it's a great question. I get asked this all the time, and it happens for sure. What I usually say is if they're sick, you have to go attend to them. If they have a fever, they're coughing, of course, you have to go attend to them like you normally would. And then what usually happens is babies who used to be lousy sleepers, who then are good sleepers, they quickly become lousy sleepers again, quickly. But usually they get fixed very quickly again. So you wait till they're better from the cold or whatever. And then it's usually one night. And you're like, no, we're not doing this again. And then they're done. Teething, I find most people who come into clinic tell me that their kids are not sleeping well because they're teething. 4 months, starts at 4 months, 6 months, 9 months, wherever. Teething, keeping them up all night, Maybe so. What I'm going to tell you is that children teeth from the time they're 4 months old until they get their last set of molars when they're two, okay? You have a long time of teething. And I find that, yes, there are times when they're miserable when they're teething for one particular night or whatever. Long-term sleep problems are not because of teething, okay? They're just not. So yes, a bad night here and there, but if you find that it's like one or two bad nights and you see that they've got little blood blisters and they're popping through, yeah, I mean, they could, but it's not going to hurt them for weeks and weeks and weeks. So again, get through the acute event and then, you know, stop it.
Okay. Yeah. When you go through a cry out method, our biggest challenge has always been the naps.
Yeah.
Nighttime, she seems, my baby seems okay.
Yeah.
But naps is so challenging.
Yeah.
Through the day.
It's a question about naps, and that during sleep training, for this question, the baby does pretty well with cry it out methods during the night, but nap times are horrible and super, super hard. So that's a common thing as well. Night times always get better faster than naps. Always. Nighttime sleep organizes itself before nap times do. It's really common. So it kind of depends on how old your kid.
Now she's 14 months.
14 months, okay. So two naps a day still? Or one?
No.
No.
One.
One, okay.
If
one, okay. So, so most babies over a year who are doing okay during the night and are struggling for their naps, it's super common. The best thing that you can try and do if you are okay with the cry it out is pick a time of day when nap time is, and you are very consistent about putting them down at the same time, and you let them, if you're okay with it, and I'm not saying you have to do this, like I said, no judgment, whatever you want to do, you let them cry. And you know what most of the extinction folks like Weissbluth, if you read his book, will say is, you say nap time is an hour, and you stay in your crib for an hour, and you can cry through the hour, or you can go to sleep for the hour. But you are consistent about putting them in at the same time every day. You know, most babies are still doing two naps until 18 months. So it could be that they're a little short on, your child is a little short on sleep anyway. So sometimes trying to reestablish two naps is helpful at 13 to 14, 15 months, but it depends.
The one that she takes she does take a small nap in the morning, mm-hmm. and then the other one, she attends daycare. So the other one, she does well sometimes,
yeah.
But when we have her during the weekend,
yeah, all over the place.
She wants to play with mommy and daddy.
Sure,
and
yeah. So one thing is, and this sounds really mean, is that she shouldn't really get to decide that. Is that it's nap time, and she goes in, and you make a pattern, and she does it every single time. It depends how much you want to fight it. I think that a 14-month-old who doesn't nap at all during the day is going to have a hard time sleeping at night, too, because it gets into that thing where she's going to be, she's going to be super exhausted by the time she goes to sleep at night, you know? So it's going to be hard for her to fall asleep. She may have some disrupted sleep at night. It's hard to say. It really depends on the baby. But consistency with nap time is your friend. Oh, I've got a question from the, you want me to be here?
Thank you.
Oh, sure, no problem. I'm just going to kind of go around this way. I'll get to everybody. Yes.
So it's kind of a follow-up on her question.
Yeah.
I just did basically a cry it out for my 10-month-old
yeah.
daughter.
Yeah.
And she cried the whole hour. Mm-hmm. I didn't go in. I listened to her cry. I peeked in. I could see her standing up in her crib.
Yeah.
After the hour, she has this huge bruise because she's been banging her head against the bed, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so first thing I would say is it becomes an issue as babies get older. So if you have a 6-month-old, take note. Might be a good idea to do it now. So it depends how you feel about the bruising and how you feel about it. I mean, and again, it sounds like I'm so mean when I talk about this. We're going to get into like the vomiting, and we're going to get into like all the stuff that I know they all do it sometimes, as they throw up sometimes during all this. So it depends how badly you feel about it. You can try and kind of rig the crib up so there's not such hard places for her to bang her head against. But she's protesting. She doesn't want to do it. you know, she's like, forget you. I'm not going to do this. I'm going to do anything I can to get out of the crib. I mean, it sounds like I'm, you know, giving them these, like, I'm so manipulative. It's not really that. It's just this is she doesn't want to do it, you know. So I think if you can make it safer, you know, obviously that would be the best thing. Vomiting is always something that comes up, and it is just up to you. I am not going to sit here and tell you that it's okay to let your kids vomit. It is just whatever. I think that if you, it's not a serious health problem to throw up while you're crying, okay? It's not. Sounds like I'm super mean about it, but it's not. What I usually say is if you have a vomiter, older kids teach themselves how to throw up during this sometimes. I don't know if anybody has one of those. They learn how to, and then they get you in there. I'm just saying, it's not pretty, but there it is. You can set it up for success. You can put them in a couple of pairs of pajamas, have everything ready to go. You know, liner, crib sheet, they yak up. You go in, rip it off, change the pajamas, put them right back in. Sounds really mean, I know, but it's the principle. I mean, it's the principle of not too much attention around it and putting them right back in. So, yeah.
So we haven't done it at night because I'm kind of scared, but if we do it at night, how do I let her cry like 4 hours? I mean, how long do I let it get going?
Yeah, people always ask that. It's a little unusual for them to cry longer than 2 to 3 hours, but they do sometimes, especially older children. I think that video monitors help you with this if you have one, because at least your imagination doesn't run wild. You know, if all you can do is hear them screaming, you are going to imagine her, you know, hanging from the crib like this in this precarious position, when really if you could just see that she's crying but she's all right, it's probably better. It's a little unusual to go 4 hours. It's possible. It's not very common. Older kids, yeah. 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds, oh, they'll go. Mm.
So I have one more.
Yeah.
I have twins.
Okay.
And they're both in the same nursery.
Yeah.
Same group, the same nursery. And it used to be that she would sleep through his crying, but now I think it's swamped.
Yeah.
So how do I separate them?
Yeah, I for twins or for kids who are reasonably close together who you want to do a whole cry it out intervention, and you know you've got a 2.5-year-old and an 8-month-old or whatever, I usually recommend, if it depends how many rooms you have, I usually recommend doing one of them at a time. And separating them in rooms if you can, because it's very hard to do them both at once. If you have multiple rooms and you want to do everybody at once, you can. It's okay. If you have an older child who is a good sleeper and a littler one who is a horrible sleeper and they share a room, or you're worried that the little one is going to wake up the older one, you can sometimes move the older one in with you temporarily and have them sleep on a little sleeping bag or a mat next to you. You train the baby and then you move them back in together. That's a way to do it. I think for twins, it's usually easier to do them separately or at least in separate rooms. You can't do them in the same room. They just wake each other up too much.
Yes?
We don't have a separate room for the child in our home.
Yeah.
Any of these methods actually work for us?
They can. I think it's harder on parents. So if you are in the same room and you want to do a cry it out method, then I think that it's important to try and rig something up where the baby can't see you, because if they're in a crib or a bassinet or whatever right next to you and they see you, they're going to be like, what is going on? Like, well, I can see you. Come get me. Like, what is wrong with you? Don't you see me crying here? So I think that that's probably the key, is that putting some kind of, you know, like the little foldable room dividers or hang up a sheet or whatever. But it's really hard because you're right there. And I mean, it's one thing to listen to a baby screaming in another room, and it's another thing to listen to them screaming in your own room. So it is hard, but it's definitely doable. I've definitely had families who do it. Sometimes people decide to move out, you know, they leave the baby in the bedroom and they move out to the living room. You know, that's the way to do it. It's hard, but doable.
One more question. So if they do they don't go to sleep the first time and you try to, you know, out,
yeah.
And they wake up in the night, yeah. And go to sleep.
And they cannot go to sleep, yeah.
And cannot go to sleep, you let them cry it out again.
Yeah, so the question is, if let's say you're doing cry it out, they finally go to sleep after crying for a while, and then they wake up in the night again, which they will, by the way, yes, you again ignore the crying, and you continue to ignore it consistently.
Even if it's feeding, you know, my wife is feeding them.
How old?
She's 7 months.
7 months old. Again, I would argue 7-month-olds usually don't need to be fed at night, but after I said that, but that's up to you. I think that it is a really mixed message for them to sometimes get fed at night and sometimes get ignored at night, and I think it makes the whole sleep training process a lot more difficult, to just be honest with you. So I think that if you're still fairly sure that your baby needs to eat at night, and check with your pediatrician, talk to them, don't let me sway you. I think that that becomes a really hard process of trying to sleep train and continue to feed at nighttime. Does that answer your question? Okay. Yes.
So we have a 15-month-old that for one reason or another is sleeping with us.
Uh-huh. I love that, for one reason or another.
Well, if we're playing the crib, he cries like crazy. And second is that we have to stay with the baby to sleep. But if we play with us, we let him sleep with us, and
yeah,
we stay with him to sleep, he's fine.
Yeah.
So we want to train him to sleep by himself
right
in the crib. So
right,
should we do it first, like on the big bed first, or to go to the crib? Or just do everything, just throw him in the crib in his separate room.
Right.
Like, just on our bed first, sleep
yeah
by himself first, and then go to the crib.
Yeah. Okay, so the question is, this lovely man has a very nice 15-month-old who is co-sleeping right now, and they're interested in getting the baby to be an independent sleeper. And the question is, when he goes into the crib, he cries and wails, but when he sleeps with his parents, he sleeps great. So the question is, in order to sleep train him, should he go into the crib, immediately put him in there, do extinction, call it done, or should they train him to sleep alone in the big bed first and then do a stepwise approach? I think it depends on you, of course. I think that if it were me doing it, I would cold turkey it and I would put that baby in a crib in a separate room and be done. Because I think you're going to end up with a multiple stage process of a lot of crying that's going to be prolonged. I mean, I'm not really sure, and I think it depends on what your theory is. Is it better to have lower level crying for a longer period of time, or is it better to have really intense crying for a shorter period of time? Because I think those are kind of the choices that you would kind of end up with. Yeah, and that was the other thing I was about to say, is 15-month-olds on a big bed probably are not the greatest idea without you in the whole world anyway. It's on the floor, yeah. So sometimes people put mattresses on the floor, which obviously is much safer. My other just little piece of advice too, and this is strictly not really medical advice, is it? I don't really think it is. I think that kids should stay in cribs for as long as humanly possible. Please don't get them out of a crib and put them in a bed when they're like 18 months old. It is never a good thing. You lose all control of where they go. It never ends well. My kids are like potty trained, done. They're like, can I get out of my crib? I'm like, no, stay in there. Horrible. Yeah.
I'm just like you said, so my son is 4 months on Friday.
4 months.
They are still doing night feeding, and you should not start sleep training, or you should start?
It depends kind of how big the baby is. Do you know how much he weighs?
He's probably going to be
13 pounds, yeah. So the question is, can I train my almost 4-month-old who is 13 pounds now, or should I wait? And the answer is, I would be fine with that. I think usually babies over 12 pounds are usually okay to go without feeding. That's kind of a random number. It depends. If you're comfortable with it, it's fine. I think that babies who are eating a ton at night, again,
you should let them not eat at night, or you should try to feed them.
I would try and not feed them at night. They're usually, and again, check with your pediatrician, maybe depending if your baby's got any special issues. In general, it's really usually okay after 4 months that you can train them. I use 6 months as kind of an example, because a lot of people still think by 4 months things are going to get better, and then they usually don't. So. Gas pains, again, I think that gas pains for me, I agree, gas pains are real sometimes, yes, agreed. Sometimes they will really disturb them and make them wake up. I think gas pains fall into that category like teething, which is like, you know, really? You can't really respond to that all the time. You're like, he's got gas. I mean, everybody has gas all the time. You know what I mean? Good sleepers sleep through gas. It's okay. Yeah.
So he's a pretty good size, almost 6 months old. He did the wise sleep cry out for 30 minutes several months ago. He's actually pretty good at night sleeping. So he goes down around 8:30 and he gets up around 11:30. He does a full 8 hours feeding and then gets up around 5:30 or 6, which is okay. So the fact that he does that full 8 hours feeding at 11:30, is it really reasonable to do that, and how?
So I think that, so this question is about a good-sized 6-month-old who has been pretty well sleep trained, who eats at 8 or 8:30 before going to bed, and then another good-sized 8-ounce bottle at 11:30, wakes up for it, yes, wakes up for it, and then sleeps until 5:30 or 6 at night. My suggestion would be just do what you're doing. It's fine. I mean, because you're sleeping from 11:30 to 5. that's fine. So I would probably, if I were you, over the course of the next couple of months, maybe try and wean that down a little bit at a time, wean that feeding down a little bit at a time. And a lot of babies, if you do that, they'll start sleeping through that 11:30 feeding. There's this concept called a dream feed that some of you guys might have read about in books, which is basically like, even if your baby doesn't wake up, you wake them up at like 10 o'clock at night and you try and like tank them up, you know, like you feed, like, you know, asleep, and you like try and totally tank them up so that their bellies are full all night so they sleep better. I don't really know if that works or not. I really don't know. I hear all different things from people. Sometimes people swear by it. They're like, you have to do it. It's the most amazing thing ever. You'll like be so happy. It's just wonderful. And I'm like, fine, do it. It's good. There's other people who are like, it just doesn't work. And it doesn't seem to adjust the sleep schedules at all. It sounds to me like probably because you've done some sleep training, you're on a fairly good schedule. And it's 8 ounces is a lot to eat at 11:30. So does he need those calories right at that moment? Probably not. But it's probably not so bad that you have to like do a whole bunch right now. I'd probably just try and wean it down and see if he starts sleeping through at 11:30. You could do either watering it down, or you could just do less volume. Or you could not, and you could just do what you're doing and see if he stops. It's just a lot of calories at that time of day. So it depends. So some babies are like, I'm going to suck down my 8 ounces and I'm not going to have any less than my 8 ounces, and I want my 8 ounces and that's it. That situation is probably better to water down, because at least they get the volume, right? And they're like feeling full for the minute and it satisfies them. You know, some babies just are asleep and you could take the bottle at any time and they would go down after 4 ounces. That's the baby, probably just less total.
Yeah. What if they're not getting the number of naps per day, but they're getting the quantity?
So the quantity of sleep. 3.5 hour napper. Yeah. How old's your baby? Almost 6 months. So a 6-month-old who is not getting the number of naps but is doing a long quantity of sleep just in a shorter number of naps of the day. Is your 6-month-old doing 2 naps a day or 1 nap a day?
The early morning, 20 minutes, and then 3.5 hours.
Okay. So the question is, the nap pattern is a 6-month-old with a 20-minute little cat nap in the morning and then a big old honkin', you know, 2 or 3 hour nap in the middle of the day, and then sleeping well at night or no?
No?
Okay. I don't know why I ask, you guys are all here. So it's okay. I mean, it's not awful. I think that, you know, it's a good number of hours of sleep. I think that one thing to look at is, because of that long middle of the day nap, is there a really long period of time in between the middle of the day nap and the bedtime? Because sometimes a long stretch between like whatever, 1 and you're putting the baby to bed at 8 or whatever, that's too long for a 6-month-old to be up. So that's going to disrupt the nighttime sleep as well. That's going to make them cycle through their sleep cycles faster and probably be fairly disruptive. So, you know, some people will say, this is a little like, you know, trial and error, to not let them sleep for 3 hours in the middle of the day. Wake them up after an hour and a half, get them up, and then do another little cat nap in the late afternoon. Or the other alternative is you let them do that big long sleep in the middle of the day and you move the bedtime earlier, which might actually be better for you guys. So it's the timing of the naps doesn't concern me so much. It's sort of that long period in between the middle of the day and the bedtime.
And when your slide gives the normal sleep pattern and says, you know, 6 months wakes up once or sleeps and that wakes up once, does that mean feed? It's okay to feed, or does that mean?
I think this for a 6-month-old who wakes up once, who you know has good sleep habits, who you can lay down awake and they fall asleep on their own, who wakes up once, eats quickly, and goes right back to sleep on their own, and they've been slowly decreasing the number of feedings that they're doing over time, that is a baby who might outgrow that feeding on their own, right? So that would be okay to watch and wait and see what happens. If you have a 6-month-old who is waking up every 2 hours and you have to do this until they fall back asleep, that's not a 6-month-old who's probably going to do it. Does that make sense? Okay. Yes?
What's your recommended solution if a child has extreme psychological fears of staying alone in the room?
Mm-hmm. How old is your child?
3.5.
Okay, so this is a question about a very fearful 3.5-year-old of staying alone in the room at night. And so let me just ask you, does your child come in, does sleep with you now?
Every night she wakes up twice a day, and it's been the same since birth.
Yeah. Okay, so this is a child who wakes up twice a night, and does she start in her room ever or no?
Very recently, and only because, you know, we are putting her along with her older sister.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so...
But even then, it's still
She's coming in, yeah. So you can approach this in a number of ways. This is a very entrenched habit, probably because this has been going on for a very long time. It actually does help if you have an older sibling who's in the room. They often will go to bed at least in there. So it depends how consistent you want to be. You can move yourself into her room. This is basically the extinction with parental presence method, where you move yourself as a parent into the child's room with the older sister or not, whatever you want to do. And you tell them, this is for older kids, 3 years old, you say, you have to sleep in your bed. You have to stay in your bed all night. I'm going to be right here so that whenever you wake up, you're going to see that I'm right here next to you. And the only rule for you is you have to stay in your bed. Okay. So once you're in there, there's not a whole bunch of reason for them to get out of bed to find you because you're right there. So the idea with this is that a 3-year-old who's very fearful starts building confidence in sleeping in their own bed in their own room. 3-year-olds respond reasonably well to rewards and sticker charts, and anybody who's potty trained, anybody knows, you know. So you whatever works for your child, charts and stickers and M&Ms and whatever, Polly Pockets and princesses and mermaids, whatever works for your 3-year-old. But basically, the idea then is once they're sleeping pretty soundly most of the night with you sleeping next to them, then you start moving yourself slowly out of the room. So you take your little air mattress or whatever, and you move 3 feet away. And you say, okay, your whole job, you have to stay in your room, and or in your bed. And if you do that for 4 nights in a row and you get a sticker on your chart every 4 nights, you know, then we're going to go to Toys R Us and you're going to get something fabulous. And then you move it out again. And then you move into the hall. And then you eventually move yourself back to your room. So the idea is that the fear in that age group is usually being alone, so sometimes siblings do help, but it's basically building their confidence so that they become less fearful. So that's a method I recommend a lot for older kids who are really, really scared. So, yeah?
Our baby's not born yet, but is it
good. A good idea? Good, you're here! I will never see you guys in my clinic. That's awesome.
Is it a good idea to have the crib in our room?
It's a great question. So I get asked this a lot. So the official American Academy of Pediatrics recommendation is to have your child sleeping in a crib or bassinet in your room for the first 6 months. So I think that's fine. I think that that's great. I think that I'm not sure that works for everybody. I know I'm like, oh, against the American Academy of Pediatrics. But, you know, like, it depends on the kid. So, like, my daughter, who was my first one, she was so ridiculously noisy and snorty. I was like, I couldn't sleep. She wasn't sleeping. Every time she moved, I'd be like, it was my first kid too, so you know. I was like, oh, are you breathing? All this stuff. And so she wasn't sleeping. I wasn't sleeping. And by about week 3, my husband's like, she's out of here. We are done with this. And so we moved her out. My second one, my son, super quiet. He was in there for a long time. He was in there, I don't even remember, 5 or 6 months. So it kind of depends on the kid. So that is the official recommendation. I think that I think they should have their own spot to sleep in. I think they should have their own crib or their own bassinet. So that's kind of the official thing. I think that, though, even when you have a really little baby, you know, even when you have a 6-week-old or a 2-month-old, you can start practicing a lot of this stuff so you don't end up in a situation where you have to, like, do this intensive sleep training. And I recommend a lot to my patients who I see who are younger, you know, one thing that you can do is you can put them down where they're still a little bit awake. So instead of, like, rocking, feeding, you know, until they're totally asleep, wait, drowsy but awake. So a little bit sleepy, but you put them down and it teaches them to fall asleep on their own, even from the time that they're really little. So that's something to consider. Did that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Oh my gosh, so many questions. Yeah.
So my 16-month-old daughter, actually we co-sleep, so her crib is next to our bed, and she never sleeps in her crib, but...
It's there.
There. No, meaning like we moved her to her crib once she's asleep.
Okay.
And most of the times, even if she gets up, she can sleep herself, but sometimes she comes over onto her bed. And is that okay? It doesn't bother my sleep or anything.
So the question is, this is a family who is co-sleeping. The baby is 16 months, falls asleep in bed with parents, and then while asleep gets moved into the crib, and then sometimes stays there and sometimes comes back in, and it doesn't bother her mom, and it's all good, and it seems fine. That's fine with me. If it works, I mean, a lot of this is if it works for you and if it's okay for you and it's not bothering you, then it's okay. I think I do get a lot of families who it's all working fine when you have one child who's 15 months. And then another baby comes along and you're like, uh-oh. what am I going to do with the second one? Where are they going to go? Are they going over here? The other side of the bed? So I think that there are some issues that come up with the second one. But, you know, it's one of those things. It's very personal. If it works for you, if it works for the baby, it's fine. What I will say is it often doesn't work for husbands. I'm just going to say. That's all I'm going to say on that topic. Yes?
I have an 8-month-old baby boy and a 2.5-year-old girl who's not a good sleeper. And he's still in our room. I attempt to put him in his room because say it's only 2 bedrooms.
Yeah.
So we're always worried about waking her up.
Yeah.
He actually probably would have been a decent sleeper, but I've created a bad sleeper because I didn't want him to cry at night and wake her up.
Right.
And I've gotten him to the all-night nursing. And so instead of doing the cry out, you said don't just stop the feeding right away. What should I do that's not now something worse?
Right.
In the middle of the night, he's going to wake up, he's going to be crying. What
right.
do I do?
Right. Okay. So this is a family who has an 8-month-old and a 2.5-year-old. The 2.5-year-old is not a great sleeper. And the 8-month-old is a nurse all-nighter in mom's room. And they both are not great sleepers. And they have a 2-bedroom. So what do they do with that? So a couple things. One is that this really depends on what your capacity for crying is and what you're willing to listen to.
I'm not good at that with my daughter. But
I'm sorry. Say again. It's okay.
I proved not good at listening to her cry, mm-hmm, but mm-hmm. I'm going to be tougher this time.
Okay. So this is one of the situations where I would consider, I don't know how bad of a sleeper your 2.5-year-old is, but I would consider having your 2.5-year-old move in with you and move the baby to the other room and sleep train the baby first. It's usually the easier thing to do because babies usually are easier to sleep train, number one. I know he's nursing all night. I would just cut, I mean, he's 8 months old. I would just cut him off. Yeah, he's probably ready. Yeah, he probably doesn't need that all night. So, I don't need to tell you that. So,
don't just leave him in the crib. You just do cold turkey, even though he's.
And I know it sounds, again, I really am a nice person in the end. I mean, it's just, you know, in that situation, you got to get your stuff done, right?
And his diaper is wet. So I put him in the crib at 8 at night, but he wakes up at midnight. And he goes pretty well into the crib at 8, drowsy, but awake.
Good.
Then the screaming really starts in the middle of the night if I don't pick him up and nurse him. But his diaper is soaked
at midnight?
Midnight or 2 a.m.
So a couple things. One is that if he doesn't nurse all night, he probably won't have so much of a soak diaper, would be one. Secondly, I am totally okay with double diapering kids so you don't have to wake them up. So get a bigger size and just two on top of each other. No, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay to do that. Disruptively going and changing a wet diaper, I think is not going to behoove you. It's not going to help. I think that, you know, for a baby who eats a lot in the late evening hours, they're going to pee a lot. So I think that there's that. So I think it's actually good. I don't think he's going to be that bad of a sleeper. You're telling me some little good things about him. I mean, he falls asleep by himself. You said, I mean, he's gotten in some habits just because he's been in with you. But I predict sometimes I'm wrong, but I bet he'll be an easy sleep trainer.
And last question, just when it was really cold in the winter, his hands were freezing.
It is okay. To have cold hands. It is okay. I feel like it should be like there's like some things, like there should be a public service announcement. It is okay for babies to have cold hands. It doesn't mean that they're really cold. Like if you feel his chest, that's his core body temperature.
But when he slept with me, he was so warm.
Yeah, because yeah, I know he was. No. I know. But it's again, I don't think it's something that would really probably keep him up. It's really normal. It's okay for them to be a little cold. You can double PJ him too. You can double diaper and double PJ him.
I do
that too with my kids. I double PJ them sometimes. I know. I'm just teasing, but you know, it's okay. They do get cold sometimes on their noses and their hands too when it's cold out. And as long as they're, you know, as long as they're warm enough on their tummies, then that's okay.
Yes. My daughter's 3.5, mm-hmm, and she goes to sleep usually somewhere in the 8 o'clock hour, mm-hmm, wakes up usually around 6 or somewhere in the 6 o'clock, so that's like 10 hours at, mm-hmm, night, mm-hmm, and then she takes like a 1.5 to 2-hour nap, mm-hmm, and so I'm wondering, I see that she should be getting about 13 hours and no naps, and she does still take a nap pretty consistently,
yeah,
so I'm wondering if there's something I need to look at.
Yeah, in general, so the question is, a 3-year-old who goes to bed at about 8, gets up about 6, so takes about 10, he sleeps about 10 hours at night, and then does about an hour, maybe an hour and a half-ish nap in the middle. Hour and a half to two, sorry about that, hour nap in the middle of the day, so totaling about, you know, 11, what, like
12.
about 12 hours. And on my chart, I had 13 hours. I think that if she's happy and lovely and not tired and not behaviorally having problems and falls asleep by herself, I would say that's fine. Three-year-olds often are giving up their nap by three, but some don't. Some hang on to it. I also find that kids who are in daycare or who are in school, sometimes they have a mandated nap. It's actually something in California that one of the laws is they have to take a nap. They have to take a rest until they go to kindergarten. So there's a lot of four-year-olds who I see who are like taking this nap in the middle of the day, and then they won't go to bed at night because they really don't need that much sleep. And so, you know, it becomes a bedtime issue. So she will probably drop the nap at some point, at which point I would say if she drops the nap, that's a time you usually need to move the bedtime a little bit earlier because she still needs to get those number of hours of sleep.
So keep offering the nap until she starts not falling asleep.
Yeah, until she starts not falling asleep. Yeah, so the question is keep offering the nap until she starts not falling asleep. Yes, I think that you can. It is a sad, sad day when the nap goes away. I love the nap too. And it is a sad, sad time when it goes away. But at the end of the day, at some point what will happen is they won't fall asleep. You can try and institute quiet time. I'm a big believer in quiet time. That doesn't work for that long. You got that for maybe, what, 3-4 months, you guys, maybe? People who've been through this? And then you're just done. So, yeah. Okay, other questions? Yeah.
When would you transition from crib to big kids bed?
When would I transition from crib to big kids bed? I like to keep them in cribs as long as possible because I think that when you move them out from a crib to a bed, you lose all control. You lose all control of what they're doing. So you cannot keep them anywhere. Now, there are kids who learn how to climb out of a crib, and that's a safety issue, and that's a problem. So they do sell things called crib tents that you may have seen, which are sort of like the top of the cage of the crib that you can attach, and it's sort of like this netting sort of thing. So you can do that. Sometimes that works. There are very, very many very resourceful 2-year-olds who will figure out how to take those off. So I think if it is a safety issue, you have to get them out.
The thing is, another one's coming in.
And you need the crib, yes. So. Totally, yeah, totally big issue is I have got one. I want to get one out of the crib and because I got to use it for the baby. I really, and I know it's hard, I really, just think big picture. You got a new baby coming. You are kicking your older one out of the crib and giving it to the baby. It's not going to be pretty. I would say borrow a bassinet for the baby for a while. Have a little transition time there. You don't need a big crib for the baby for a while. Borrow one, Craigslist, whatever you need to do. But it's not a good thing for older, like 2-year-olds or even 18-month-olds to get kicked out of their crib. Don't do a bed. Don't do it. You lose all control. And then I start talking to people who have a 2-year-old who's in a toddler bed who gets out all night, out, 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 out. And then we're talking about putting gates up in the door and keeping them in the room. And don't do it. Yes.
My kid was gradually good sleep until 4 years.
Okay.
But after that, she went to vacation alone to grandparents and came back. She has some sense of insecurity. And it's been 6 months. I'm trying hard to put her into bed, sleep alone, but no, she's not waking. Earlier, it was like, it's my room, it's my bed, go away. Now it's like, don't go.
Yeah, yeah.
So what is the possible thing I can do? I have slept for a week on the ground with her patient.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm here, but even then she's not at home.
Not going for it. So this is a 4-year-old who used to be a good sleeper who then went to go visit grandparents. And how long did she stay with grandparents?
1 month.
1 month. And co-slept while she was there?
She was sleeping with grandparents.
Yeah. And then came back and now is a co-sleeper and doesn't want to sleep by herself. And this really nice mom has tried everything, including sleeping on the floor with her and trying to get her to sleep independently. So I think that one question is your child really fearful? I mean, can you just see that fear? Or do you think this is a little bit of a, I'm getting you to do what I want you to do?
Sometimes she's okay, sometimes she says it's monster is around.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Type of things she says.
What do you really think? Because I'm just asking, because 4-year-olds are very, you know how 4-year-olds are.
Yeah.
Do you think she's playing you, or do you think she's really scared? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Like she's really scary, and that day she definitely comes back 5 to 6 times over the night.
Okay. So with 4-year-olds, you can reason with. Okay. So 4-year-olds, if this is truly something that she has developed a real, true phobia, a super bad fear that she is just not, you've tried the sleeping with her, the whole, you know, sleeping in and then moving out and all that stuff, and it's just not working, I do sometimes recommend that you go see a child psychologist about it, because sometimes they can work on that really true deep-seated fear. Not really sure that that's what's going on. You can correct me, and it may be, and that might be it, but sometimes four-year-olds are very, very smart, and they have gotten very used to something, and they're very happy with the new situation. And I find that four-year-olds, girl, correct? Four-year-old girls have a lot of ability to be motivated by the correct motivator. Sometimes it's finding the correct thing. I find that oftentimes it's sort of like the three-year-old who won't potty train. It's they know the process, they know what to do, they know what you want her to, she knows what you want her to do. It's very clear, she's smart, she gets the whole thing. Sometimes it's having the right motivator to get her to do what you want her to do. And I really go at that point for bribery. I go for big ticket items. And I know this sounds really crazy, but it's like the three-year-old who won't potty train is like, okay, here is, for girls, the makeup set that I would never ever let you have. Okay, and you put it up high in the bathroom, you know, and you say, when you're ready, we're gonna do this. And it's a similar thing for something like this. If you think that this is more of a behavioral thing that you could convince her with, you know, most parents know the thing, you know, something really, really fabulous.
Everything is related to behavior.
Yeah.
Because she sleeps like 3-4 days by herself, and I said, okay, I'm going to give you a new book. Mm-hmm. So she slept, but every day she was asking a new book.
So she can be motivated, right? So four-year-olds need to be motivated in all things. And so, you know, figure out what it is that motivates her. If she's a book girl, and it's something really good, and then you get it, you have to buy it, and then you put it someplace she can't have it. You have to put it up high so she can see it. And then you stop talking about it. And you say, when you are ready to sleep in your bed for 5 nights and you get 5 stickers on your chart, you can have that. And then you don't talk about it, you don't convince, you don't cajole, you don't anything. When she gets the 5, or whatever it is, 5 or 6 is usually good for a 4-year-old, then she can have it. If she can do it, and then she immediately goes back again, it's behavior. It's all behavior. And then you can work on it a little bit at a time. But I mean, it's often finding the right motivator. If you really think she's that scared, because some kids do get very fearful, and I mean, not even just around sleep. They get, you know, whatever, bit by a dog, and they just get crazy fears around dogs or whatever. It does help to work with a psychologist or a counselor, because sometimes they can help them, but I don't know.
Like
doesn't
sound.
Yeah.
I see, but sometimes.
Yeah. It's probably work on the positive motivation with it. I think that might help. Yeah.
So along those lines, when you take a baby out, you go out for vacations mm-hmm. or why not week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. How can you get them readjusted while you're out of out?
Yeah.
And then once you're back.
Yeah, so the question is about what if we travel, we go on vacation, we, you know, do whatever, we have to be out of our routine. It's really normal. Babies, they all backtrack. You switch time zones. You know, you go visit grandparents who are not going to listen to one iota of crying. Let me just tell you that. No grandparents will do that. So, you know, you just, usually, I'm just saying, not everybody maybe, but it's hard to convince them. I think you just have to write it off. And you have to be like, we're gone for 2 weeks. It's going to be horrible. They're going to sleep badly. That's when you realize that when you travel with your children, it's not a vacation, it's just traveling. Right? I mean, anybody who has kids knows that, right? I mean, the earlier you come to acceptance with that, just the better it is. So if you want a vacation, you have to have somebody else take care of your children. So you expect it to be bad, you expect not to sleep, you expect it to be really bad, and then if you've sleep trained them before, you get back, and then you put them back on the schedule, and it takes like 1 or 2 nights. So. Yes?
So our 3-year-old goes down pretty well at night, you know, 15 minutes of, you know, maybe not, you know, dad, I can go back and check on him. But he wakes up religiously at 4:30 in the morning and will not go back to sleep. He's wide awake and ready to go at 4:30.
Yeah.
And I can only take so much of that before I'm going to go crazy.
Right. What does he do at 4? So the question is, a 3-year-old who goes down pretty well, does a little bit of, you know, curtain calls and drinks and this and that, but pretty good, and then sleeps religiously till 4:30 in the morning, and then wakes up and is ready for the day. Does he nap?
About 2 hours, usually about 1 to 3.
Is he in school?
Daycare.
What time does he go to bed?
So we start the routine about 7:30, and he usually sleep by 8:15.
The early morning wakers are so hard at 3. I wish I could fix them. And I really have very little to offer you. They're so hard. He's going to outgrow it. He's going to stop doing it at some point. He gets up and he wants to play, right? He wants to get up and he wants to watch TV. Yep, yeah. You can, you know, three-year-olds are harder to negotiate with. They don't really even, they kind of remember from one thing to the next, but you can't really make a plan for them. You can try a sticker chart, but it doesn't really work. They just wake up early sometimes. They are morning larks. Did you like spring forward? Was it helpful for you at all? A little bit? Okay, and then he reverted back. Sometimes spring forward helps a little bit. I have nothing for you. If you got rid of the nap at school, it would help. And they'll never get rid of it. If it's a center daycare, they'll never do it.
He's pretty exhausted by one.
Yeah.
So he's still kind of needy.
Yeah, it's hard. It depends. A home daycare, sometimes they'll wake them up after an hour. Center daycares will never do that. I know, it's horrible. I have nothing to tell you. He will outgrow it. I promise you he will outgrow it eventually. The early morning wakers, even if you let them cry, it doesn't really help. I don't know if you've ever tried it, but
he yells and yells and then eventually gets out of bed and starts slamming the door.
Right, because he's three and he's not in a crib. And he's,
he can just escalate and eventually.
Yeah, he'll eventually get it. So, and you know, at 4:30, is 4:30 morning? I don't know, maybe. It's kind of morning. He'll outgrow it. He will get better with it. I know it's hard though. 4:30 is really early.
One question about naps. My daughter actually naps for 30 minutes. Her naps are typically only 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. She doesn't seem to take in like an hour nap unless she wakes up and stays up all night. That the night following day she does sleep for like a couple of hours. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. Every time she gets up from the nap, she seems like she's still tired. And we still keep rocking her. Still doesn't work.
Yeah.
It's just that she has an alarm in the morning. Whatever, you know, during the day, like 30 minutes and she's done.
How old is she again? Okay, so this is a 7-month-old who takes little cat naps and doesn't take decent naps and sleeps for half an hour at a time and then wakes up and still seems tired. And so she is, okay, let me ask you one more question. Does she know how to fall asleep by herself or no?
No.
Yeah, you gotta fix that. Because what's happening is she's waking up half an hour in, you know, so she's having a little quick sleep cycle. She falls asleep, she wakes up, what do I do? She's still tired, she doesn't know how to put herself back to sleep. So, you know, and you can try the rocking. This is when the rocking and all that stuff, it stops working. It works when they're 2 months old. It doesn't work when they're 7 months old anymore. So until she learns that skill, you're going to have these little awful naps. Sorry. But you know, that's why. That's why it happens. Yeah?
So we have a 12-month-old. He has absolutely no coping skills. He can't calm himself down. So if we start some kind of cry it out program at home, he's in daycare for like 10 hours a day, mm-hmm. they definitely won't do cry it out there.
Mm-hmm.
So I think right now they put him in a swing or they'll like rock him and hold him. How will that?
What I would probably try and do, if you can, is when you have a longish weekend where you've got at least 3 or 4 days where you can work on it, or if you can take a day off around the weekend, I would probably try and sleep train him over the 3 or 4 days. I would talk to daycare, and if you're getting pretty good with the naps, I would ask them if they could at least try and put him down without rocking him or doing that stuff. Is it a home daycare? It's a center daycare. Yeah, they just won't change usually, but you can try. That said, if you get him trained at night, a lot of times babies who are in daycare, they will do what they do in daycare, and they will learn to sleep at night how you train them to sleep. Your issue will probably be over the weekends, the naps will not be so super. But I think it would probably still be worth doing, because I think that, you know, sometimes what you'll find too is that if they get better at night consistently for a while, then they actually do get better at nap time during the day. You may also find that during the weekend, if he's in his own spot, in his own crib, he knows what to do. I think I didn't say the question for the tape. The question was a 12-month-old who has a hard time falling asleep on his own, and they're thinking about maybe doing some cry it out, but he's in daycare for 10 hours a day, and at daycare there's a lot of facilitation of rocking and that kind of stuff going on, so what to do about that. So I don't know if that helps you answer your question. I think it would still be worth it to do it for the night times. As much consistency as you can get, they learn faster, is sort of the, yeah.
And as far as keeping them in a crib, he's in like a little co-sleeper, but it's set up as a crib, it's not attached.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that's a better thing to use inside his room because you're afraid of them hitting themselves and on the wood or anything like that?
So it's a co. So the question is, he's sleeping in a little co-sleeper now next to parents' bed, right? And they're thinking about if they're moving him into another room, is it better to keep him in that thing because maybe it's a little bit softer and a little bit more snuggly, and maybe he's not going to whack his head like this poor lady over here with her child. I think that if you're going to sleep train a 12-month-old, if he's any good, decent size, how long do you think he's going to be able to be in that co-sleeper anyway? It's on the floor. It's like a pack and play type of thing, so it's pretty good size. I think if it's something that you think he could be in for a while, then it would be fine. I think that would give him some familiarity. I think if it's something where you think you're going to have to get him out of it again in another couple of months, you may as well start with the long-term plan, you know what I mean? But if it's big enough, yeah, you could definitely move it and give him a little sense of, this is my spot. That'd be good. One more back here.
We have a 3-month-old.
Yeah.
We don't know when he wants to think of that. So if he falls asleep by himself, and should we get him on a pattern?
3-month-olds do not have nap schedules. The question is, this is a family who has a 3-month-old who has sort of, they're not really sure when he needs to take a nap. He kind of falls asleep when he wants to, but he knows how to fall asleep by himself, it sounds like, which is a great habit. Keep working on that. 3-month-olds do not have nap patterns. They just don't. Everybody wants their 3-month-old to have a nap pattern, and they really don't. The first nap that you're going to see emerge for a 4-month-old is usually about an hour or hour and a half after they wake up in the morning. If he's starting to do that, that's the first nap. So establish that as your first nap. Put him down awake, okay? Let him do that nap. Over time, you're going to see a middle of the day nap emerge as well, and sometimes a third one too. But it takes usually until 6 months to get those 3 naps established. Does that make sense? Yeah, that's the first one. You're seeing the first one happening. More questions? Yeah.
So my daughter was premature when she was born, so she got into the habit of eating a little less, and probably, I mean, she's still a snacker, and once she gets, you know, progressive, she's like, I'm done. So she does eat like every hour and a half, and probably leading to the habit now. And that's why we're still feeding her tonight, because she kind of needs it, I guess, or maybe not, I don't know, but
yeah,
can we stop, even though she's a snacker?
So the question is, this dad's asking me about a preemie. How preemie was she?
3 weeks.
3 weeks preemie. Okay. She's not that preemie. So she's 3 weeks preemie. She you know, they got into the habit of eating little bits at a time because they're, you know, naturally you're worried because your baby's early that she's needing all that nutrition and still continues to feed a lot at night. And she's 10 months, you said, from before? I'm sorry, 7 months before. Yeah, I mean, check with your pediatrician, check on her weight, make sure. But 3 weeks, you know, I think that she's, how much does she weigh now about?
15.
Yeah, she's ready. She's okay. So 15-pound, 7-month-old doesn't need to eat every hour and a half. Who's your pediatrician? I better call them. So I told this nice dad. Yeah.
So when I put my baby down to sleep in at night, I have found that, I tried and cried out when she was 4 months, and she cried for 3 hours nonstop until my heart just couldn't take it anymore. Different things. The point is that now she can pretty much sleep through the night and go back to sleep on her own. But the nighttime routine, if I let her, well, she doesn't take naps, so that's why I've been trying to do different things to get her to take the naps. And she goes to bed really early, by 6:30 she's in bed. There are times that it's hard for her to fall asleep, but like crying out, it just definitely hasn't worked for her ever. You mentioned that having a 15 to 20 minute soothing time should be fine, and then put them down. But like sometimes I find myself having soothing routines of like almost an hour, and then I put her almost awake in her crib, and she's fine. Is that okay?
I think anything that's working for you is okay. It sounds like, you know, I'm not saying that crying out is right for everybody. You know, I think that, you know, if you have gone through that and it did not work for you, then that's totally okay. If it works okay for you to have an hour-long process before you put her to bed, that's fine. It sounds like she's sleeping reasonably well at nighttime. Remind me how old she is again. She's 14 months, yeah, and I mean, it may just be that she's a baby who's going to get better on her own. She's just going to develop some of those soothing habits on her own and just get better.
And her soothing habit, that, like for a couple of weeks it was then found,
yeah.
And then I tried different things, but her sleeping habit right now is to pinch herself. Is that normal?
Yeah, so one question about this little 14-month-old soothing habit is to pinch herself. Yeah, it's pretty normal, a really common one. They pull their hair, they pull their ears, they can find a little spot on their skin and rub it until it's raw. It sounds crazy. Headbanging is a huge one, if anybody's got a headbanger. Yep.
Are they going to grow that? Or?
She'll outgrow it at some point. Could do a long time. Probably not 20. Sometime between now and 20. Anything else? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Nice to see you guys. Yay.